It might seem like an unusual pairing, art and law, but the reason I guess I was interested is partly my own personal background, but also that idea that artists have worked with many, collaborated with many kinds of professionals, but not so much the legal community or the legal mind. It's quite clear in some of the artists that are in the exhibition that they have already investigated this territory before, and just from interacting with them, when they describe their practice and their research, quite often artists talk about a level of engagement, but nothing formalised. And the proposition was simply that artists would access the research material, but be able to do that with a kind of a mentor, a critical friend from the legal community, that could be a judge, a barrister, a legal historian, academic, whatever, so that the finer understandings of that case material would unfold.
I like to use a role reversal on most of my work to ask questions about the past that will hopefully give us a little bit more direction on where we need to go in the future with regards to the Aboriginal position and rights in Australia. For me, it's about finding out a little bit about my identity. The reason I went into the art industry after 25 years of commercial photography was me wanting to know more about my Aboriginality. I was adopted and brought up in a white family with a mother that fought for Indigenous rights her whole life. So a lot of my work comes from the stories that she used to tell me when I was growing up. But later on in life, it was for me, it was about finding out about my Indigenous ancestry and a little bit more about my history and identities. I find that these projects are a really good way of me learning about Indigenous history in general, which is something that I never learnt at school in the 70s and 80s. I find that a lot of the time in Australia we still suffer a fair bit of racial discrimination. So for me, I use fairly simple titles and I produce my work sometimes off a title to create work that asks a lot of questions. It's very open work. And I like to ask a lot of questions, and I do it in a role reversal way. I find that that's a really simple way to maybe look at our history and for a broader range of Australians to understand a little bit more about maybe some of the Indigenous issues, how sometimes that everything that we see is not always in black and white. There's a lot more sort of complex issues in between.
My work as a whole kind of looks at how the world is changing because of new technologies and with the passage of time, and how this is affecting us in good ways and in bad ways, and sort of the things that we're leaving behind. The whole idea of the animals was that they're meant to be kind of hidden in the paintings, and they're meant to sort of not look 100% comfortable, and they're sort of tentatively walking around the paintings, and they're meant to sort of hint at the alien way that we too may feel about rooms full of books in years to come.
It's a work about my mother's passing away in 2006. We all construct our archives of personal memories with photography directly through photo albums and other memorabilia, but society construct their own archives in forms of libraries, museums. And you could say that the law is an archive of ideas and norms and rules and regulations that direct our living together. My artwork is firmly based in my personal life. It's a very intuitive process, and it's a very changeable process, because what interests me obviously changes over my life. I really believe we cannot understand our present without knowing the history. I think that's inextricably linked, and on all levels, whether it's personal or society or, you know, law. We can't understand what happens now without understanding the past. Art is about change. It transforms objects and transforms spaces. It transforms times and feelings.
And I don't think like the text is either really negative or positive, but it interests me because they're all drawn from moments where I've noticed that people have like really different understandings of one particular situation. And I'm really interested in showing the works so that I can maybe engage other people in contemplating these kind of things and how we relate to each other within these systems. I guess I'm compelled to like investigate the various systems of control that like regulate bodies and identities and how we're allowed to be and exist in the world and express ourselves. So like In terms of the work I make, I think I'm interested in making work that I can use to experiment with gender modifications and with how people respond to those modifications and just to like the ideas of gender variance in general. I find it really hard to judge how people will receive my work because I think I found that like people's reading of me as the artist really influences their reading of the work, and there's like seems to be heaps of different ways that people will perceive me. So sometimes like when I'm making a work, I'll try and think through how it might be received by others, but it gets really complicated because I'm thinking about all the different ways that people will see me and see the artwork, and so there's so many variables that I usually just like make whatever work I want to and hope that it does like encourage like that does encourage like and continue the variety of like understandings of the work and me as the artist.
Under the Act is a series of prints, the etchings, which overlay documents from the state archives, from my grandmother's and my great-grandmother's files. So that's Grace Isaacson and Mabel Daly's files. And these are overlaid with images of blood and looking at how blood, or what's seen as the states would say quantum of blood, or here it would be sort of quantities of blood, change the perspective on how a person is treated. And in the case of Aboriginal people, decrees who has freedom and who doesn't. And in the case of my Aboriginal family, they didn't have freedom because of their what was in their blood, which was Aboriginality. I think it's important to always start beneath the ground, what lies beneath the ground. So that would be something that I would be looking at here in the siting of the Supreme Court, looking at the land upon which this building is standing, looking at the people from this area, looking at the history of those people and then people who came after them, and seeing the impact of the law upon the rest of the community.
Evolution is a really good word to use to describe the path that that you take as an artist, and so often I look back and I feel like I've come a very long way, but with each work is perhaps a small step towards maybe a subtle change in my practice. I feel like I've always had an eye to the past, even insofar as I'm a painter and a realist. I make oil painting, and it's very traditional modes of painting. And so often when I'm even just technically pushing myself or investigating something, I look to the past rather than to something that is contemporary. And that in and of itself just keeps me located in this in a certain tradition, I guess, in a history. I think it's always a good thing when art invades any space. It helps us reconsider that space, and it helps, I think, bring different meaning to the work itself. I think a shift in context is always enables that shift in meaning, and that's always a good thing, even in a small way.
Inside the works, I've used my travel documents. I was travelling between Sydney and Melbourne, visiting with lawyers and marriage counsellors and collaborative mediators. So, the most enormous pile of paperwork with travel documents and legal documents and copies of this and agendas from those meetings, and I have shredded them and I've used them inside the works. None of them are visible. They've got all records of everything at the time, whether they're medical records, legal records, and they've got copies of my marriage certificate and the legal vows that we wrote. It was the best I could do in my own way to shred all this stuff, make these works, and get these two figures moving along. I was wearing it so much every day, that legal process. For months, years it went on. And locking that stuff away in those cabinets took a lot of it out of my heart and mind, and it gave me somewhere to to place my frustration and my fatigue with it, with the whole process.
The use of the ochres and the machine in it, and sort of that idea of the water bleeding these ochres down is something that I can't predict how it's going to work out. So this, I suppose the process with this one was a very intuitive, I suppose, process in a sense, where there was a direction, but the result was something that I had to keep going over and over again until it actually felt to me that it was actually saying what I wanted to say. Conceptually, I needed to keep the elements that were talking about it, and there was there's always that idea of the aesthetic and going, oh, that looks good, but conceptually it's not happening. So it was working around those elements of back and forth and putting dealing with the concepts of it and dealing with the aesthetic and trying to work out something that still spoke exactly what I needed to, but something that could be read, I suppose, and sort of invited people in and had a depth to it. It wasn't just a facade, an image. There was something that people could spend time with and see more into the images as they look into them.
John was spot on in describing or comparing the legal mind to the artistic mind in that way, that thing about being deliberate and being consistent. And I think that they're nice things as an artist to be. But then that danger of being too mechanical or a bit too safe as well, like finding that space in between. There's often a process that the artist has, which is tends to surprise the public. They tend to think that things are much more organic and emotional and just thrown about in accidents, but that it's not that an artist's life is boring, but that they often enjoy that more administrative side and that more planned out side and that more cerebral side as well. So I think that they're things that have a really nice parallel. What it is doing is actually showing the absence of the creature. There's a lot of things that you can get from that then as the viewer. Is it a extinct species? Is it a strange kind of fossil? Is it representing something like thoughts and aspirations that have just gone beyond the page?